Hello, everyone. Can you hear me? All right. Hello, and welcome to the 6th annual SCN8A Clinician, Researcher, and Family Gathering. We are going to open with a message from the Cute Syndrome Foundation founder and director, Hillary Savoy.
Hello, and welcome to the Cute Syndrome Foundation's 6th annual SCN8A Clinician, Researcher, and Family Gathering. Also, our first virtual gathering. Thank you so much for joining us. I'm going to ask you all to hang with me here for a bit. We're not going to start late. Recently, I had reason to write to the FDA. I opened my letter to them by explaining that I'm tired. I suppose at the end of 2020, the idea of being tired of all of this isn't particularly novel. However, when I said I was tired, I wasn't speaking to coronavirus. I sent my letter to FDA on a Saturday after spending my evening talking on the phone with an exceptional mother about the difficult decisions ahead of her as she contemplated her son's care from the PICU after status and a 25-minute cardiac arrest. This is her son, Milo. Milo is absolutely a superhero. His strength and determination in his recovery thus far is nothing short of breathtaking. Not all of our children do recover, though. This is Varia. Isn't she perfect? She completely stole my heart, as did her mother, who was determined to help her daughter no matter what it took, no matter what the doctor said. Varia died on November 5th, the second child in our community to die in a single week. She died while we were attempting to coordinate remote access to expert care, after weeks of her seizing 40 times a day, resistant to rescue medications, regularly being resuscitated by ambu bag by her mother. As I explained to the FDA in my letter, I'm not tired of being there for our SCN8A community for these moments. In fact, it is one of the great honors of my life to support these families in moments like this. But I am tired of these things being normal for our community. So in consideration of throwing out what's normal here, let's recognize that this gathering is not like any other. Those of us who understand this event know that what has always made it special is connection. It's the unexpected interaction with a child with SCN8A or their sibling. It's the understanding that comes from hearing a child have a seizure in the back of the room as a scientist talks about his or her research. And it is, yes, in true Cute Syndrome form, in the conversations at the bar after the event that illuminate the kinds of unexpected truths that we couldn't find unless we just came together as curious, compassionate humans, not just medical professionals and researchers, but families too, all wanting to help those with SCN8A. These connections, they help focus us. So this year, as a team, we focused on what there's to gain in a virtual setting. We've cut back the formal presentations in favor of conversation. We've shortened the event. We have people joining us today who could never join for an in-person meeting. People from all around the world. People who couldn't otherwise travel to be with us. Like, I'm sure you guys have already figured out, based on the noise next to me, for the first time in six gatherings, my daughter Esme. Esme, can you say hi? Can you say hi, please? Give me a smile. Let's see. Ah. She's not playing along. But she is happy to be here. And we are all here to advance the understanding of SCN8A in ways that improve the lives of those affected by it. Perhaps sometimes the paths there are indirect. They can be found in unlikely connections, like the ones made by this unforgettable young man.
Hi, I'm Billy Town. I miss you guys. I miss you. I love you. I miss you. You're so cute.
Billy, what's the name of what you have?
Cute syndrome.
What does that mean?
If I said what?
What's it mean if you have cute syndrome?
I'm so cute.
Ladies and gentlemen, Billy Tone, in the full version of this video, which you can watch together with all of our children's videos in the expo or over break in the videos. You can see that Billy goes on to draw a picture of Shelley from Canada, who is my second in command at the Cute Syndrome Foundation, as well as Dr. Johannesson, who we'll hear from in a bit, who both of whom Billy met last year in Baltimore and who stuck with him. And he stuck with them as well. Dr. Johannesson remembered Billy specifically in the pre-gathering educational series for our families a couple of weeks ago. These links, they're important. They drive us. For the last 5 years, we've asked all of you to come into some big room at AES with us, lay eyes on our children, listen to them, smile at them. And I know how much that has touched so many of you. So today, throughout this meeting, we're going to bring our children right into your offices, your homes, to guide you in videos made by their parents. And what better guide than this young man, Nico, who many of you may remember meeting in DC.
My name is Nico. I'm Shaggy. I have SCN8A.
I learned how to talk this year.
I am 4
years.
Years.
Seizure.
Seizure free. Thank.
Say thank you.
Free. Fix you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Nico wants to say thank you because his gains, guided by an understanding of his mutation, have helped him communicate and demonstrate his intelligence. His pride, his visible pride, makes me think about what really matters to our children. You may all remember Casey Craig's talk in New Orleans when she shared the notion of having to choose between seizures and smiles when she thought about medication for her daughter, Stella. And here's Stella, introduced by her big brother, Lincoln.
Hi, my name is Lincoln, and this is my little sister, Stella. I want to keep her smiling and giggling, but increases to her current meds take them away, and we don't want that to happen. So can you please make a medicine to keep the smiles and giggles here and take seizures away for good? Thank you.
Good job, Stella.
Just over the last few days of gathering planning, Casey and Stella were in for an overnight EEG, and it's clear that Stella may require another medication increase due to increased seizure activity. And the question Casey is asking is, will Stella be able to giggle on the other side of that? This is what matters to Stella. It's what matters to her mom, to her dad, and certainly to her big brother Lincoln. It's what matters to me. And it should be at the heart of how we advance science, expert clinical care, and drug development for these children. Life presents us with all manner of things to get bogged down in. But my job here today, and in general, is to orient us. It's been a long year. There have been some devastating hiccups. Some we've all felt, and some have been more intimate. However, there is also something about moments in time, like the one we're living through, that are crystallizing. They give us perspective. They help us understand what's really important. They help us understand what we're all doing here. Let me introduce you to a friend of mine, Cam.
Be the last one standing, two hands in the air, I'm a champion. You'll be looking up at me when it's over. I live for the battle, I'm a soldier. Yeah, I'm a fighter like Rocky. Put your flag on your back like Ali. Yeah, I'm the greatest, I'm stronger. Bet my dues can't lose, I'm my own, yeah. Hey, I've been working my whole life. And now it's too
when we live and work in a world of children like Cam, like Esme, who do things that are certainly impossible for them, when we live and work with mothers who find the strength to literally push life back into their own children's lungs repeatedly, there is no question about who we are here to keep up with, who we are here to focus on, and how to talk about what actually matters. So today, together, let's run at this like Cam. And in that spirit, we're gonna get started.
I don't know how we thought that I was going to be able to come back on here without tears, but whew. All right, guys. Hillary, thank you. Not only for your beautiful welcome, but do our tribute to our children and for all the blood, sweat, and tears that you've devoted to our SCN8A families and children the past 7 years. The passion you have for each and every one of our kids does not go unnoticed, and we will be forever grateful for your advocacy and friendship. Welcome, everyone. My name is Casey Craig, and you just witnessed my SCN8A warrior, Stella, and her amazing big brother, Lincoln, and Hillary's welcome video. I'm so incredibly proud of them both. I volunteer for the Cute Syndrome Foundation for the past 2 years and was somehow roped into moderating the clinical trial readiness series over the past few months. I guess I didn't mess up too badly because I'm back today and seeing my favorite day of the year, the annual SCN8A Clinician Researcher and Family Gathering. Excuse me, the tears are still there. Of course, COVID-19 has changed the look of our gathering this year as we come together in a virtual event instead of in person. But I believe you will still find the magic of this event is still present as we gather together, families, clinicians, and researchers, all fighting for the same cause because we are stronger together. Let's just put this out there from the very start. Virtual events are inherently slightly awkward as we all navigate the technology. So let's just assume my audio will not work at least during during this event. A speaker may get lost in the internet ether on their way to a session. Let's bank on a PowerPoint not loading for the first attempt. A mic won't unmute, or a delay will make a conversation feel like the moon landing. Or our main welcome event will stop unexpectedly and we miss an amazing video. Please, please, please take a moment over a break and go back into the expo area and watch that full video. You will not be sorry. But as our SCN8A kids have taught us, we can roll with the unknown and even embrace it. Before we get started, we do have a few housekeeping items. Group interaction, questions, and or comments will take place in the chat box to your right. Please type questions and or comments in the chat box to engage with Roundtable panelists. You may also direct message and even video chat directly with others outside of the sessions. So click on the tab People and you will choose who do you want to talk to outside of the session. To your left, there's a tab titled Expo. In this area, you will find the loveliest videos that parents made and submitted on their own of their SCN8A warriors. Please take a moment during the built-in breaks to enjoy these beautiful stories. Also, you can prepare yourselves for the research discussion by watching Michael Hammer's featured presentation on sex and strain differences in the natural history of the SCN8A in 1768D mouse model. You will also find a troubleshooting area in the expo. If you're experiencing technical issues throughout the event, you may check out this troubleshooting area, or you may also type a request for help in the chat box. Our fabulous technical guru, Megan Barner, will help you tackle any technical issues you might have today. Again, a very warm welcome to all of you here today. Our community of SCN8A clinicians, researchers, industry partners, and families that has come together with us today. I also want to extend a huge thank you to our sponsors for this event, Neurocrine, Praxis, Zogenix, and Greenwich Biosciences. We would also like to thank NORD for the event support through their COVID Rapid Response Seed Grant. Coming up, we have a clinician roundtable where we will hear some clinical and industry updates and then share in a discussion facilitated by Drs. John Schreiber and Manoj Patel. After a brief break, we will come back for the researcher roundtable, as well as some time to focus on the family experience of SCN8A. After that, we will welcome you to join us for a cocktail mocktail party. I will now hand this over to Manoj and John. Wait and see, there we go. Hi, John.
Okay, hi. We have a nice clinician roundtable prepared here. Hillary, I don't know if you had planned on doing introductions for folks, but I can give a brief synopsis.
Yeah, why don't you go ahead? I'll let you run the show, and I'll use my handy 1 minute warning sign when we get through the presentations. So I'll pop off and I'll be here if you need me.
So I think the intent was to have 10 minute presentations, allow another 5 minutes afterwards for questions and to make this a discussion as well. So first we have Alana Gardella, who has over the years really been a stalwart speaker here at the SCN8A gathering. I'm so pleased that she is back today to talk about her work in loss of functions variants in SCN8A. She just brings a wealth of knowledge in SCN8A and in various forms of genetic epilepsies in general, and just has a tremendous cohort of patients that she'll talk about now. I'll leave it to you.
Thank you, John. Seeing you again. Thank you. I would like to talk about this research about sleep in the SCN8A children and adults, some adults in the cohort. I would like to share some slides. I don't know whether I have to share my screen or I've sent also the slide. Should I share my screen?
Yes, if you can share your screen, I would. Yeah. I'm not sure about the functionality of this platform here.
Yeah. Can you see my screen?
At the bottom of your screen, you should be able to.
Hey, I'm just popping on to see if I can help out at all. I think, yes, if you're able to share your screen, that'd be great. But if for some reason that's not working, we do have your slides that I can pop it up.
Yeah. I think I mix up the presentations. Elaine, you'll be talking about sleep in SCN8A. And Katrine will be talking about loss of functions, I think.
I can see the function, but I cannot activate. I mean, cannot start the sharing.
Okay. Let me see what I can do on my side here.
Yes, probably works now.
Can you see this?
Can you see my screen now?
Yes, I can see that. Can everyone else see that?
Yes.
Okay, great.
Okay, so I got it. Yeah, I move quickly to, we know everybody that people, children and adults with epilepsy are at risk for having a disturbed sleep. And especially we are this experience that families and parents of children with SCN8A mutation comes and say that their children have a problem with sleep. So just starting from this concept that also know that in the literature, the mice model for SCN8A has sleep problems, especially with REM sleep and the transition between REM and non-REM sleep, we started taking a look at the possible sleep disturbances. And you know, this study is a collaboration between European and USA patients and families. Thank you everybody for having contributed to that. And it's a work in progress because we haven't concluded the work so far. We collected the clinical data and the question of you know the questionnaires because you provided the data to us, right? And the main questionnaire is the sleep disorder scale for children and the children's sleep habits questionnaire. That the main the two main which are we have used, and we have 39 patients which are going to join this study. We have now the material for 32, and there are 17 female and 15 male in age between 2 and 32 years. And the comorbidities there, which can impair sleep, are autistic feature, autism, ADHD, and gastrointestinal symptom, mainly represented by reflux. As you can see, most of these patients, most of them are children. You see the mean age is about 11 years, had severe intellectual disability and motor impairment. So that means also hypotonia and cerebroparesis, some of them. Only 25% have a moderate and 16 are mild impairment. And just two children are totally normal from the motor and cognitive point of view. So that means that there are some neurological impairment that can contribute to sleep disturbances. All these patients had epilepsy and with a variety of seizure and a frequency which is ranging from monthly to daily seizure. Just two patients are seizure free, and most of them are three or more anti-epileptic drugs. As regards the seizure time, more than 0.5% of these patients have seizure during sleep, and another half a seizure not related to sleep, or four patients do not have seizure at all. They are seizure free at the moment of the investigation. So we started saying that the caregivers reported a frequency of sleep problems in 23 out of 32 of this patient, 73%. And actually we could document with the scale, the sleep disturbance scale of children, we could document that 66% of these children had a clear-cut impairment of the total sleep score. And impairment means over 60% of impairment. That means highly pathological or mild pathological, and another 20% or borderline actually. And despite that, only 31% of the patient took medication to assist sleep. Going into details very briefly, I will say that the biggest problem into the taste of the sleep problems was the difficulty of initiating and maintaining sleep, which affected more than one half of the patient. Together with that, we also some difficulty with sleep breathing disorder, sleep wake transition disorder, and some moderate daytime sleepiness. You see that we try also to evaluate whether some other parameters could influence this sleep disturbances. And we couldn't find any association between gender and age of the patient, motor impairment, or respiratory or gastrointestinal problems. We didn't find an association with the seizure frequency either. But we also evaluate whether the presence of seizure during a sleep or the sleep predominance of seizure could influence their sleep disturbances. Is actually the number are very low, so we are still collecting a patient, but the first impression is probably comparing patient with sleep related seizure with patient with seizure not related to sleep or mainly during wakefulness. We say that at least the problems of sleep breathing during sleep breathing disorders were more accentuated in patient with seizure during sleep, giving the suspicion that this might be in part seizure related, or we have some undetected seizure during sleep. And actually regarding the sleep wake transition disorder and the sleepiness during daytime seems to be quite similar, roughly. Perhaps we guess that possibly also this difficulty in initiating and maintaining sleep, which is in any case an issue both in patients with sleep-related seizure, not sleep-related seizure, might be a little bit more accentuated in patients with sleep-related seizure, giving the impression that perhaps seizure also influenced this parameter. Still working on that, this is preliminary data in any case, allowed to assess the prevalence and the type of the sleep disturbance in this patient. We confirmed that a large percentage of patients with SCN8A epilepsy has sleep problems, and mainly consisting of sleep difficulty in initiating sleep and sleep instability, which has some moderate daytime sleepiness. I mean, and despite that, a few of them are taking medication to assist sleep, and the symptoms severity is not apparently related to seizure frequency. It's also, we also serve some of the patients are seizure free, having problem with the sleep maintenance. So actually, this suggests that it's a good idea checking the sleep and the quality of sleep also in patients which are low seizure rate or are seizure free. Regarding the physiological consideration, this patient, we know, I mentioned when from manual study, we know that there is probably an effect of the SCN8A mutation as well as SCN1A on sleep balance. So possibly, the genetic abnormalities per se can negatively impair sleep. But we cannot neglect that there are some complex and bidirectional relationships between sleep and epilepsy. So probably seizure, especially seizure during sleep, can also influence the sleep quality in this patient. And we also, no matter whether it's more the mutation or more the epilepsy, the disruption of the sleep, the low quality of the sleep is definitely influencing also the cognition and behavioral issue in a negative way. So actually, we really like to go further into detail supporting the study of the investigation in children and also in young adults with SCN8A mutation, supporting the investigation on the nocturnal sleep, and suggesting that they should be probably, we should pay probably more attention to this disorder than deserve to be treated. And also we really like to discriminate whether in every single patient is the epilepsy component has to be treated, or is just the stability of the sleep that has to be treated. And this is has to be evaluated case by case. And this is our group of connection. I thank you, everybody of my group and around the world, including the presence. But most of all, I have to really give my great gratitude to all the families which contributed generously to this study. And I, of course, I'm thankful to Hilary, to Cinzia, who has been doing a great work from the Italian Association, and to Roland, which has been contributed pretty generously, pretty much to that. And I do thank you all for your contribution. And thank you so much for giving me the possibility to talk about this data.
Thank you so much. That was an excellent presentation and something I think a lot of the parents here really appreciate as well. Manoj, it looks like you had a question. It looks like about 31% of patients in this study are on sleep medications. Manoj, you had a question about sleep medications and sleep, right?
Yeah, I mean, should the children be on it? It seems like there's a nice correlation between lack of sleep and seizures. And I think Frank Kalume has done some stuff on the Dravet mice. So what are your thoughts to the, this is to the two clinicians?
Yeah, I think actually, generally speaking, I guess that the seizure, because you know everybody that seizure can also be really clinically mild, so it can be undetected during sleep. So probably my feeling is that they can largely contribute to seizure disturbance, sleep disturbance. But we also have seen patients which are potentially seizure free, having not the very severe degree of seizure, sleep disturbance, but having a quite disturbed sleep and very the tendency to frequent arousal. So probably, I guess seizure impair really much, but not all that.
Yeah. A question I have is, we know that there's a link between, you mentioned this bidirectional relationship between seizures and sleep, which we certainly see day to day in all sorts of epilepsies. But the the other thing is the relationship between SUDEP and sleep. You know, we know that having generalized tonic-clonic seizures in sleep increases your risk of SUDEP. Did you find that patients with more disordered, I don't know if you had any in your cohort that succumbed to SUDEP, but is that something that you found or something you think you might see, that more disordered sleep tends to correlate with a higher risk of SUDEP?
That's definitely to be investigated, but you know, also my position about SUDEP in SCN8A, you know, that I know SUDEP, of course, is an issue, is a problem, but I also I'm convinced that many of the children that we called start for SUDEP, but then also, I mean, for our group, we started describing that for SUDEP, if you look into the taste, actually, is not a sudden aspect that this is a progressive degeneration. So actually, I mean that the number of patients died for SUDEP are not that high, but definitely has to be investigated. It's an interesting issue. It's a good question.
Yeah, I wonder how many are just not reported as well. That's something I think the registry can help get at. Did you find, were any certain anti-seizure medications correlated with worse sleep? We know that a lot of our anti-seizure medications can disrupt sleep and sometimes just do away with slow wave, that restorative sleep. It numbers probably weren't big enough, but any correlation?
Actually, we find it's not, a surprise. We find some relation between daytime sleepiness and the use of barbiturates and benzodiazepine, but this was also expected. And otherwise, nothing.
I see we just had a comment from Andrew saying that his SCN8A knockout mice also have abnormal sleep architecture. So that's kind of interesting and something we can follow up on.
Yeah, exactly. We tried also to quantify the REM sleep. Actually, REM sleep in the patient will have some overnight sleep, which aren't going to quantify. We are quantified our own, and we're going to quantify some coming from outside. And so far, not big difference in REM sleep, but the arousal rate, I mean, the micro arousal rate is quite increased.
Let's see, looking at some other questions coming up here in the chat. I'm seeing some comments on medications and that kind of thing used. There are some general questions about what medications might be useful and if VNS could potentially be useful with sleep. I know now you can change VNS settings during sleep. I'm not aware of any literature on VNS being helpful for sleep, but other medications or other things that might be helpful for sleep in particular in these patients.
So here's a question, I think, there's a question of interest from Virginia and Dave Young, and it does the seizure disorder lead to sleep disorders, or do the meds to control the seizures contribute to disturbed sleep? I think you may have touched on that a little bit. Or does the lack of sleep contribute to seizures? They're all interconnected. I mean, I would think that the seizures, because I know in the mice that seizures disturb the sleep patterns. And then it's just like a vicious circle. So they don't sleep as well. And so that could aggravate the whole system. What are your thoughts on that, Elena?
I totally agree with you. I totally agree. Because definitely, especially, I mean, seizure deprivation is a great, I mean, risk factor for sleep deprivation, for having seizure. And especially what we saw in our patient, talking about in interictal activity. The interictal activity increased pretty much in the transition from light sleep to slow sleep, especially in the CAP period. It is increasing pretty much, the interictal. I'm not saying that it's the same that having seizure, but probably is a critical, period during sleep, where is the that generate probably lower threshold. You're just guessing. I guess that they contribute both directions.
Yeah, and Michael Hammer just said in their mouse 1768 mouse that they see seizures and then sleep disruption follows, and when there's gaps in seizures, sleep seems to recover. So that's really interesting. Well, thank you so much. I think that addresses most of the questions, but I know there will be a way, I think, to get questions to people after this if there's some that come up. and we'll have some more time for discussion later. So thanks so much again, Elena. This was excellent work, as always. And I think if Katrine is ready, now we'll have her talk about the loss of function. Folks, I think I mixed up your presentations there. So Katrine. I'm going to share your audio and video. Great.
I'm here.
Hi, great. Good to see you. So Katrine is another becoming a frequent member of this discussion, this group, and has contributed lots of great work to the SCN8A community. So we're so thankful to have you here again talking about the loss of function variants in SCN8A.
Yes, so this is definitely for you, Billy, and for all the patients like you. And then I will see if I can do this. So you see my screen?
Yes.
You see my screen?
Yes, we do.
So this is
Yes, we do.
Okay, great. So this is preliminary data on our small cohort of loss of function patients in SCN8A. I'm just gonna try to describe the phenotypic spectrum for you. So first of all, what we did, we included all the patients that we know are loss of function. That's the one that have stop mutations like Billy or have deletions or something like that, but also all the patients that have been functionally tested. So it's a few so far, so that's 40. And then we use this prediction tool that you can find online. And we included 20 variants that had predicted loss of function. I just want to add the comment that with this prediction tool, I of course also looked at the phenotype of the patients to see if it made sense. So in total, we included 60 patients so far, but since I talked to some of you guys a couple of weeks back, I can probably include more patients. So these are kind of the data that we have so far. So first of all, we looked at cognition in these patients. And as you see, actually quite a lot of them are either have normal cognition or just mildly delayed. Of course, there are still patients that have moderate or severe ID, but compared to the gain of function patients, which you see here on the right, the proportion is much smaller. So it appears that these patients are a little bit more well functioning. And you know, just keep Billy in mind, you will know. We also looked at other features beside cognition. And Andrew, I will have to look into the sleep issues in these patients. We haven't assessed this yet, but what we see is that they have quite a lot of behavioral issues, such as ADHD and autistic features, or maybe even an autism diagnosis. A lot of them have language delay of some sort, and a lot of them have ataxia or other movement disorders. We are trying to look into the ataxia subgroup of these patients because we find it quite interesting. We have also done work in the SCN2A gene where there's also ataxia involved. So we want to try to see if we can go
Katrina,
into a little bit more detail on this.
Advancing. I'm not sure why that is.
But we will definitely have.
It looks like your slides aren't advancing. You're still on the title slide.
Sorry?
I don't know if any UCSF folks know how to remedy this.
Oh.
Maybe try going into presentation mode, someone suggested.
Yeah, but I was in presentation mode. Maybe I can just.
Yeah, maybe refresh your browser and see if that helps sometimes.
You still see only the.
Oh.
Okay, now it moved.
Now we're good.
So it looks like now we're on your methods slide.
Not really. Oh, now it worked.
We see the slide that says methods.
If I just use this one, you
now,
can see it.
Now cognition. I'm not sure which one you want to be on, but so right now you're on cognition.
Yeah. So if I just do it like this, you can see it. So I just wanted to, this was the functional prediction tool. This was what I wanted to show about cognition, with the large majority being normal or only mild AD compared to gain of function, where the large majority have severe ID or moderate ID. These were some of the additional features that we found. And then, of course, we looked at epilepsy. What's interesting, of course, is that it's just 60% or about 60% that have epilepsy. Please bear in mind that I come from an epilepsy center, so this might be very biased towards epilepsy, so this number might be even lower compared to gain of function, where it's all of the patients that have epilepsy. A striking difference that we also saw was that the median seizure onset in loss of function was 33 months, so quite late onset compared to the 4 months that we see in the gain of function. We also saw that when we look at like these epilepsy types, we call it late onset generalized genetic epilepsy, unclassified, no epilepsy, and then the DEE, that's the developmental and epileptic encephalopathy. It's just a very, very small portion in these loss of function patients, where the majority definitely have no epilepsy or have some form of generalized epilepsy, most often with delayed onset. So the seizure types include absences, febrile seizures even, which are not that common in gain of function patients, and also generalized tonic-clonic seizures and myoclonic seizures we see a lot of. So this actually makes it, makes the phenotype of these loss of function patients quite different to the gain of function patients. And I guess this will be quite important when we start doing clinical trials where we want to treat perhaps gain of function patients for a start. I think it's quite crucial that we treat only gain of function patients and not these loss of function cases, because that would potentially, of course, worsen their phenotype. We did also look at the treatment response in these cases. Of course, it's we had 60 patients, but only 60% of them have seizures. So it's not a large cohort. But we did see that those who become seizure-free and those who have seizure reduction, they mainly have it with non-sodium channel blockers, which makes sense. Whereas worsening or side effects are typically seen with sodium channel blockers. The best drug to use, I don't actually know, but it appears that a lot of patients have a good response with valproic acid or even levetiracetam, which I know that it's is dangerous in SCN8A because so many patients have reported adverse effects. Perhaps that's related to the gain of function, but I can't tell you for sure. This is definitely something we will have to look into. And also lamotrigine, there was quite a good response. So these are some of the preliminary data that we have in these loss of function patients. It's of course still an ongoing project, so we are still open to include more patients. And as I said, I think it will be very important to like try to explain the differences and what we the differences that we can actually see without doing the actual functional testing, which takes a lot of time and a lot of manpower, especially when as we are approaching clinical trials. Yeah, with that, thank you to all of the wonderful families and kids out there. You're an excellent patient group. I love you guys. So thank you
so much. That was excellent, Katrine. It's, I think, really, really vital to understand loss of function versus gain of function, as you said, for determining which patients may be appropriate for sodium channel blockers and other, you know, clinical trials that are looking at the same that same mechanism.
I had a quick question, if I could start with one before, as we read down. Some of the phenotypes you describe are a little bit like Dravet, right, with the febrile seizures. Is that correct? I think we may have. Is Katrine still on? Maybe John, you can help answer that.
Maybe just say it again because apparently my internet connection is really bad.
Okay, I was interested when you talked about some of the clinical phenotypes of the loss of function, but the febrile seizures and some of Dravet's is Dravet syndrome. Has similar features. Can you elaborate on that a little bit?
Well, I guess these are genes that are so homologue. So I guess it would make sense that when we see a loss of function SCN8A phenotype, why wouldn't it resemble or at least have some characteristics that are similar to the loss of function SCN1A? I mean, these are, we don't even know if they are solely located at the excitatory neurons or if they can also be located in other places. There has been suggestions on this. So it will be quite interesting to see if other more basic scientists can help us on that.
Yeah. And so I guess
I was going to say, I wouldn't say Dravet necessarily, but other, you know, GEFs plus, maybe that phenotype.
Exactly.
Because, you know, as you said, it does seem like they're more genetic generalized epilepsies, which would fit more with that GEFS plus phenotype.
Exactly, yeah.
So I'm just reading down. So I had one.
Yeah, somebody said that there's a lot of SCN8A kits, but actually these are kits that are quite well functioning, and if they don't even have epilepsy, perhaps we don't even know them yet, right? Because I guess epilepsy patients are some of the patients that actually have genetic testing done to a quite large extent. Whereas in Denmark and Europe, at least, genetic testing in like just intellectual disability or autism patients, it's not really that common yet. So there will probably be a lot of patients out there that we simply don't know yet that aren't genetically tested yet.
Yeah, definitely. Can you talk some about how you determine or how one might determine if a missense variant might result in loss or gain of function?
Yeah, this is quite difficult. We're looking into seeing if there is some kind of genotype correlation at like location in the gene. We saw that a little bit with the SCN2A, but of course we would like a bit more patients with known loss of function missense variants to help us with this. So I guess time will tell if we can use like location or something like this to guide us as to whether it could be loss of function.
Yeah, I love this question from Eric Wenger. It's about the motor phenotype and loss of function SCN8A patients. I agree.
Yeah, that the roundtable last week
was a great presentation using a Parkinson's disease scale.
Yeah, because we do see a lot of movement disorders in these patients. So we've been mainly looking into the ataxia, but there's definitely a lot more to it than just the ataxia, for sure.
And I can say we had a movement disorder specialist see around 20 patients with SCN8A ourselves and found that there were multiple kinds of dyskinesias, dystonias, sometimes very complex movement disorders.
Yeah. Yeah, also no, choreatic movements.
Great. We had another question. Do loss of function, just flipped up. Do loss of function also have autonomic dysfunction that is often seen in gain of function?
I can't rule it out for sure. We haven't specifically looked into this yet. So we will probably have to look into that as well.
And I may have missed this in your talk, but what percentage of the patients that you see have SCN8A loss of function over gain of function?
So currently we have in our large cohort, we have these confirmed, we have these 40 loss of function, and we have like, I think it's almost 140 gain of function.
Okay, thank you.
So right now it's the balance is not equal, but as I said, it's probably due to a bias towards epilepsy patients.
Thank you.
Great, exactly. So I think we have people want to charter a flight over to see you and Elena.
Yeah, you're welcome.
So we'll have to have them arrange that after the pandemic.
Hopefully we can see you all next year.
No, just such a wonderful talk, and I'm sure there'll be more questions and things that come from this. So thanks so much for sharing that data, and I'm hoping we'll see this published soon. Is this submitted yet?
The large paper should be submitted before Christmas.
Good luck with that. Excellent. Thank you so much.
I hope. Thank you.
All right. Now, I think we have a couple of folks from industry. We have Gabby Belfort, and I know we have I believe it's Dietrich Haubenberger from Neurocrine who's presenting. So Gabby, are you ready? Thanks so much for coming.
Certainly, and thank you so much for giving us the time, John and Manoj. It's a pleasure to get a chance to speak with both of you again and to be here. I'll just say it's always an honor and a privilege to get to speak to patient groups like this. Just looking at those videos of Stella, Cam, and Nico, and others is so inspiring. And of course, getting to hear Hillary speak is always incredibly motivating and orienting. And it's nice to see Esme up on the screen. I'll just briefly divert into an anecdote, which is that I got to spend a little bit of time with Hillary and Esme on the beach this past summer and took Esme out into the ocean surfing. So if you get to see shots of Esme surfing, I'm very proud to say I had a little hand in that. So I'm here to talk to you about our sodium channel blocker, which is really, it's not just a next generation, but it's like a third, fourth generation ahead of what's currently available on the market. What we're really excited about is that the current sort of class of sodium channel blockers that are out there, it's like, you know, they're molecules that block the function of the channel completely. And I think you heard some of the parents complaining that, you know, we can stop seizures, but then we don't see giggles. And so I think one of the goals of our program in developing this molecule, which is called PRAX562, is to go after the channel in a very more specific way, and instead of blocking its function completely, block the little bit of leakage that we see in children who have a gain of function. So yeah, the molecule is in particular useful. And I think you saw that in Katrine's talk that the sodium channel blockers tend to be more useful for patients with gain of function and not always beneficial for children with loss of function. So we are again developing a novel sodium channel blocker, again called PRAX562, for children with gain of function variants. And we're again really excited about it because it's not, it's been designed not to completely wipe out channel function, which is where you end up with kids that aren't giggling anymore. And yeah, they may not be seizing, but they tend to be heavily sedated. So the hypothesis we're going to work towards understanding in the clinic in the next couple of years is whether or not by targeting the channel very specifically on something called leak current or persistent current, whether or not we can both reduce seizures and maintain giggles. So I'll tell you a little bit about where the molecule is in development right now and kind of get you looking forward into the next couple of years of what we think is our roadmap towards getting this molecule into some patients. So take a step back first and say in 2018 at AES, at the Acute Syndrome Foundation meeting there, I attended. And at that time, our CEO, Kieran Reddy, gave a talk about PRAX 330. PRAX 330 turned out to be actually a safe, well-tolerated molecule, but it had a fairly long half-life. And that's something that we wanted to get rid of because we really wanted to have a molecule that we can control very closely. As many of you know, if you get too much sodium channel blockade, you can run into a lot of adverse events. And so we want to have a molecule that if we can reduce dose, the dose comes down quickly. So molecules with a long half-life, you can't do that. So now we have a brand new one called PRAX562, and it's being studied in a first-in-human adult study. That's typically where these small molecules start. That first-in-human study is in healthy volunteers, and we're just looking to see if the molecule is tolerated by human beings. That's really the first question. Is it safe, tolerated, then what does it look like if you give one dose? What does it look like in terms of what shows up in the bloodstream? And if you give two doses, do you get double the amount in the bloodstream? And not all drugs work like that. And that's not a foregone conclusion. That's an entire field called pharmacokinetics. And so that's what we're doing in this first-in-human study. Just give a dose, see how much it shows up in the bloodstream, get another group of people, give them two doses or double the dose, and see if you get double the amount in the bloodstream. So that's called a single ascending dose study, and that's where the molecule is right now. It's going very well. We continue to escalate in that study, and we're excited about it. Now, when you're done with that first study, you're really prepared for subsequent studies in adults, and we have it in mind to study this molecule in a headache syndrome that plagues primarily adults. And the reason we're going in that direction is because there's some evidence that other sodium channel blockers, not so much the orally available ones, but ones like lidocaine, can benefit people with particular headache syndromes. And so we're going to do an adult study because we're ready to do that right after we're done with the first in human. The reason we're not immediately ready to run studies in children with SCN8A or other epilepsies is because you have to do something called juvenile tox studies. Now, the way it sequences, you run your adult first in human, make sure the drug's well tolerated in adults, and then you've said, okay, now we know that, so we can kick off these juvenile tox studies. Those studies will run basically through next year, and then we're likely to be ready to conduct our first studies in patients with gain of function SCN8A mutations probably right around the beginning of 2022 or mid 2022. I can't be very precise with the timing because a lot changes and there's a lot of moving parts. So I guess I'd stop there. I know I've not spoken for my full 10 minutes, but I think it's probably better time spent answering questions and talking with John and Manoj about the development program. And yeah, just we'll end again by saying what I said at the beginning, which I want to thank Hillary and the families for having me here. One last thing is I've been reading Elena Gardella's papers and for a number of years now. So it's this is the first time I've had a chance to hear her speak. So I feel lucky for that too. John, Manoj, happy to field. I haven't been reading as I've been talking, but happy to field the questions that you guys have flagged if you'd like to.
Thank you.
I guess just as a general comment, I was going to say that after hearing Corinne's talk, it's quite important almost to know, particularly if the child is seizing, whether it's a loss or gain of function because of the therapy that's going to, that could be given to the child. And any comments on that, Gabby?
Yeah, you know, it's a super, super interesting question. So I think for a small molecule, you might get away with just trying it, right? So they come back, they have an 8A variant, you could potentially try. If they get worse, okay, you can back off. In clinical trials with agents that last a long time, like ASOs or viral gene therapy, you probably want to characterize every single variant in every child you administer the drug to in vitro and really understand, is this a true gain of function? Does it increase flux of ions? Is it, shift the input output curve? So I think with different approaches, you can get away with different strategies in the clinic. I mean, as an example, Katrine just presented a whole host of data where they're trying all sorts of sodium channel blockers and loss of function kids. So I don't think it's completely exclusionary that you might try. And my question, which I wanted to ask Katrine, was why did lamotrigine have a signal? Like, that doesn't make complete sense to me in the loss of function kids.
Yeah. I wonder if it relates to seizure type as well. If you're using lamotrigine for absence, it's one of the accepted therapies. That's a thought.
Yeah, interesting.
I think going back to the biology there with the loss of function, I wonder what plasticity is going on, right? So, what other ion channels are being expressed, and maybe that's why lamotrigine works. Maybe there's another isoform that's being upregulated, and perhaps somewhere in the network balance that seems to work, but it is surprising.
Yeah, I think that's almost certainly true, because if you look at what Katrine said about the age of onset of the seizures, the gain of function typically with a median of 4 months, but the loss of function was people having seizure disorders come on almost 3 years into life. So how can that necessarily, if you think 8A's expression comes up around 4 months, which makes sense with the gain of function, why does it take 3 years for those loss of function children to start developing seizure disorders?
Yeah.
I think you're absolutely right. It's some downstream mechanism.
And can you talk some about the balance of trying to do studies safely in pediatric patients in particular, and finding, is there a critical period that you need to treat where you feel you might have more impact on a child?
Yeah, I mean, I think this is actually directly relevant to the conversation we were just having. So we know that there's a number of dynamics here. The one is that many children with seizures early, it sort of has a tendency to go away over time, right? As the children age, and in particular, there are changes as puberty comes on to the seizure disorder. So I think it's very important, because I think the hypothesis remains that seizures are bad for development, that the goal is to try to get in as early as possible, particularly for the gain of function children when the seizure onset is so early in life. I think the question about safety comes into really the core of what we do and what we're trying to discuss with the FDA in terms of how to conduct safe trial, which is to say, what is the risk and what is the benefit? And I think in thinking about benefit, you also have to think about what is the life of these children like with no option, so that it really changes the calculation. So for diseases that are fairly mild, I don't know, I'm sure this is not mild for the people who have it, but if you've got gout in your big toe, then you're not going to, risk taking something that's somewhat more, could generate more adverse events. But, if you've got really a condition which leaves children with so many struggles. I think you'd be willing to try something a little bit more aggressive. Obviously, these are children, and so that's the rub, right? Whereas if you had an adult with the same very severe condition, you would say, okay, look, we're going to go super strong at it. But these are children early in life with a whole life ahead of them. And so I think, you know, we really struggle with understanding that risk-benefit calculation perfectly. But, you know, I can tell you the mechanics of, you know, getting that sort of juvenile tox studies, seeing if it's safe in young animals, and then bringing it into the clinic. So all of these considerations are going together. But, you know, if you had a perfectly safe drug, we would want to go as early as possible to try to limit the impact that the seizures have on the child. Did I answer your question?
Yes, definitely. Thank you. Let's see some other questions in the chat. One just came up about whether or not a child will be able to enter clinical trial while on current medications. I think, you know, a question arises from that. You know, what medications might be reasonable to include as concomitant medications in a clinical trial? That might be something which is a little hard to discuss.
No. I mean, I think we can talk about it since we're not there yet. We could talk about it in sort of fairly high level theory, but I think that what we would want to do is give our drug the best chance of seeing if it works, right? And on the other hand, you have to balance that against, this is a deadly condition. Children die of SUDEP, right? So it's almost unethical to completely withdraw all the medications. But there's, you know, circumstances where you could consider, like, well, what if we bring them into the unit? Could we withdraw some of their medicines and then add back on the experimental medicine? So there's ways of thinking about it. The other thing to think about is the types of pharmacology. So, you know, if a child is benefiting from a non-sodium channel blocker, then we would consider keeping them on it, right? If they've had, say, okay, it's not completely eliminated their seizures, but they've had a 50% reduction on, you know, and I know Katrine said this is a kind of a difficult drug to talk about, but if they're on Keppra or something, or valproic acid, and they're getting some benefit from it, and it's like a 50% benefit, then we would want to take them off. The more tricky question is if they're on lamotrigine, carbamazepine, oxcarbazepine, phenytoin. Then you got to ask yourself, if we're adding yet another sodium channel blocker on it, then you're immediately getting, you know, sort of additive effects on the sodium channel and they're toxic on it, do we really have the window in which to assess our drug? So I think there are, you know, we don't have this completely solved yet. That's the question that we have to go after. I will say, sort of generically speaking, if you look at the studies that were conducted with cannabidiol by GW or fenfluramine by Zogenix, these were add-on studies, right? I mean, so I think that's the standard of how to do it, because it is risky to withdraw people off of medicines. But when you have the identical target, there has to be some way of carefully conducting this stuff.
So if we have time, I had one question for seeing as we've got some clinical people on board here. Are we at a point where we kind of have like the top 10 of the compounds that work, or the top five? So if a patient comes in, we would say, hey, you know, it's SCN8A, this is what we should at least try first. Have we got any of that data from all the patient information? Or is it really just a case of the pediatric neurologist deciding what they prefer or what experience they've had?
I mean, my sense of this, yeah, maybe John, you want to answer that, but.
I mean, well, it's just all based on case series, that kind of experience. There's no, you know, real, obviously controlled trials where you're looking at one therapy versus another. But, you know, I think those are still useful. And as a clinician, we certainly use those. There's also, you know, some groups have established consensus guidelines. And I know that's something that we're working on towards establishing some consensus overall, not just in regards to treatment, but, you know, diagnosis and classifying people appropriately.
So I guess it makes it difficult for, say, one of your compounds, whether it's the Neurocrine or the Praxis compound, if you're add-on therapy, you know, how do you kind of get into, you know, how do you figure out whether it's better than what the other drugs that children are on, I guess?
Yeah, I mean, that's where a sort of balanced placebo-controlled trial comes in, yeah. Right? So you can really compare your drug against, quote-unquote, an equivalent cohort. But I think the trouble in getting at your question is we just don't have huge numbers. It's a very rare disease that you're talking about. I mean, the opposite situation is just what's happening with these vaccines for COVID. So many people that are exposed to the risk that you can run a very fast vaccine trial. Which is the exact opposite with SCN8A. They're so rare, it would take forever to collect 30,000 people.
Yeah. All right.
All right. Thank you so much for the opportunity to talk.
Thank you so much for sharing that with us. It's such a pleasure to have you and the practice folks with us here.
Thanks, John. Thanks, Manoj.
All right. And now we have Dietrich Halpenberger from Neurocrine to talk about their NAV 1.6 channel blocker. We're so thankful to have Dietrich here to speak with us today. Many of you know him. He's has certainly been very involved with this community over the past year or so, and just such a pleasure to have him here with us today.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks, John. Can you guys hear me and see my screen?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. Yeah, actually, it's funny. A year or so comes actually pretty close, John. It's been a year ago, right, that at AES in Baltimore that where, you know, we had the opportunity to first, you know, formally, you know, get together and meet and you know, even although as, and I echo Hillary here, although it's, you know, would be certainly nice and also important, you know, for us, you know, to get together in person. I'm, you know, equally excited that, you know, we have this format now that allows even more folks to come together and hear what's going on, what's new, and I want to thank everybody for putting together this great meeting. Having said that, I think we're already over time, so I tried to kind of go through our update pretty quickly here. So I have a slide deck here, which has probably more slides that I'm gonna go through in detail. But I've been told that the slides are available, I think, somewhere at the booth or so. So you can click through them offline. So we want to give an update about NBI 921352, which is a new name for a molecule that has been presented before, that has been developed by Xenon Pharmaceuticals, ZEN901. We also want to introduce Neurocrine to you. Neurocrine Pharmaceuticals is a company that is neuroscience focused. We're based in San Diego, California. We have treatments on the market and also in development for conditions in the, you know, spectrum of neurology, psychiatry, and also endocrinological disorders. Most importantly, we partnered with one of the really trailblazing organizations and companies in this field, Xenon Pharmaceuticals, for the development of ZEN901, now NBI 921352, which is a highly selective and potent NaV 1.6 inhibitor for the treatment of SCN8A. DEE and other forms of epilepsy. Only very, very quickly, this is a small molecule that has been developed specifically to target NaV 1.6. As you know, where gain of function mutations in the SCN8A gene lead to the epileptic syndrome of SCN8A. And related epilepsies, and on the severe end of the spectrum, SCN8A developmental and epileptic encephalopathy. And only very briefly, you know, preclinical data has shown, and that has been presented before, that this molecule is highly active, highly potent, specifically on the channel, and it's also highly selective, as a potent compared to other non-selective sodium channel blockers, and also highly selective compared to other sodium channels, where we certainly want to stay away from, especially for SCN8A related epilepsies, as these NaV1.6 targets often are related, with issues around tolerability, and often narrow that what we call therapeutic index, which is a dose that is selective but or effective but doesn't cause yet side effects. So far, this is a compound that has completed preclinical development for phase one. And phase one, as we just heard from Gabby, thanks for priming here the development of treatments. Phase one is usually conducted in healthy adult volunteers. This compound has completed this stage where subjects receive doses, single doses, but also multiple doses for a certain period of time. And basically, the summary is that the compound in these studies has been tolerated well. Treatment side effects were rather mild and limiting. So we conclude that based on phase one in the phase one program, NaV9213352 or SCN8A, is generally well safe and well tolerated at the doses that were examined. Probably one update that we will also be sharing here at the also at the AES meeting is that Xenon has as a collaboration with Xenon, a pediatric granule formulation was developed for the adequate administration in children. Often, we know swallowing of big tablets as adults are capable to. Is for the majority of patients or for a good portion of patients not possible in the pediatric setting. So a granule formulation that allows the formulation to be dissolved on food to be administered through a G tube, for example. So that formulation has been developed for clinical studies in SCN8A DEE, and basically another type of phase one study demonstrates that this formulation is equally able to be dissolved and to enter the bloodstream, and then as we assume also the brain as the adult formulation be basically adequate for clinical trials in patients. But what I really want to talk about today is the results from the caregiver survey that has been conducted in collaboration between Xenon Pharmaceuticals and the Cute Syndrome Foundation, and many of you most likely. So as you know, last year already basically a glimpse of the data has been presented. Now we're ready to present the broader results of the caregiver survey. Why is that important for clinical development? It's really important for us, to understand us generally as a community to understand, exactly the questions that came up before. What which population in a clinical trial is that guides protocol development, inclusion, exclusion criteria, questions about what drugs are tolerated, what are not. In the literature we have case series, we have experiences from clinicians, from individual patients and caregivers. But through this exercise, it was possible really to get fairly quick input through a survey mechanism, and big thanks to Hillary and her team from a really large number of families and caregivers that really are really important elements for us as a community to understand issues, concerns, and really demonstrate also the unmet medical needs as we then also make a case for treatment development. So this was a 36 item questionnaire that was done online. It was done in a de-identified fashion, so nobody had to disclose any personal information there. It was also overseen as it should be by an ethics committee, and was conducted in 2019. So we had a total of 160 responses that were analyzed and that basically complied with the protocol, and of that we had subjects completing the survey in the United States, in Canada, UK, and Australia. So also to have really a nice international picture about the community. Two-thirds of the patients in the survey were between the age of 2 and 12 years old. But it's also important to see that also beyond, certainly population under the age of 2 years, but even over the age of 12 or 18, there were subjects that or caregivers of patients who were able to participate to this instrument. So what did we ask? What did we learn? First of all, certainly one element is on this larger scale of 100, over 100 subjects, really define the burden of the disease, and that is certainly in the realms of seizures, but also non-seizures. Speaking about developing sodium channel blockers, certainly the seizure in itself is a target symptom of interest, and here we clearly see that here at the time of seizure of disease onset, that more than half of the patients reported here in the caregiver survey, 59% had daily seizures or more. And of those, 14% more than 10 seizures per day. Compared to current seizure frequency, basically current at the time of the survey, there's still a large proportion of subjects that that describes a high seizure burden, although less than at onset, which is expected, because this is often where certain treatment response can be achieved, but it's very clear that even with existing therapies or with the course of the disease, a high proportion of patients, close to half of the subjects, still reported one or more seizure per week. So this is really far away from a goal of seizure freedom, as anti-seizure medication should aim for the goal. When we look at seizure types, this is something that has been reported before, but also here now, it was reported by caregivers in that large number of subjects, over 100 subjects. The number one seizure type is generalized tonic-clonic seizures. As we heard before, these are really the seizures that increase the risk for SUDEP that we're really worried about, and that's really unchanged from seizure onset to the time of survey, and then we see the heterogeneous pictures of seizures can be present: focal seizures, absence seizures, myoclonic, and also others. When it comes to the presentations of the disease, of the DEE phenotype, here at number one, and really also across the different age groups, intellectual disability came up here as number one, non-seizure concern in this condition, followed by hypotonia, movement disorders in this seizure population, difficulty swallowing, and other symptoms. So that is really clear paints a really important picture of the entire presentation of the disease, well beyond seizures. What is of concern in our population that we want to care about. These are really kind of the striking features, and little bit go to what was discussed before. What is being used for treatment? Doesn't surprise many, but it's very, very striking here also in that international survey of over 100 subjects that 88% of all patients were on more than one anti-seizure medication. This is not a condition that is easily treatable. That is very, very clear, and 80% had previously taken but stopped seizure medication. So basically, that treatment refractoriness is just strikingly high. Levetiracetam, Keppra, was the prior anti-seizure medication that was most commonly stopped. And at the time of the survey, oxcarbazepine was the anti-seizure medication that was most commonly used at that time. When it comes, so the survey also asked caregivers to rate the best and the worst treatment, and this you know, paints also a very clear picture here that by far patients or caregivers rated levetiracetam as by far the worst or the highest likelihood to be rated as worst seizure medication to control the disease symptoms, and oxcarbazepine was most commonly mentioned as the best as the drug that confers the best seizure control. So what are the summaries? This is very clear, and there's much more data in that survey that will come out also as a publication, and there's a poster as well. So this really demonstrates that there is a high seizure burden, multiple neurological and motor comorbidities, and largely really the inadequacy of current treatment. That even with existing treatment, you know, seizure frequency is still an issue with patients' seizures, you know, weekly or even more, even with existing treatments. I think this really demonstrates, you know, the ongoing and unmet therapeutic needs for development in that area. And so, what's next on our end? We are dedicated to research in this community and for the development of our compound in SCN8A-DEE. And we're currently engaging with the FDA. With the goal to initiate a phase 2 study in pediatric patients with SCN8A DEE. And with that, I say, you know, thank you. This is really data that, especially from the survey, that, you know, I'm you know, honored to be able to present. But really, the brunt of the work has been done, you know, by you, the parents and the caregivers, and thanks to Zenon and Hillary and her team to really be able to pull this together. And yeah, I'm looking forward to hopefully at one point get together in person again soon. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Great sharing this data, and that's, as you said, such a wonderful thing to have the engagement from this community is to complete that. Thank you. Lots of some questions about specific variants, it looks like, which we may want to kind of handle offline for some of these, and then.
When pediatric trials begin or could begin, I think that's one from Danielle.
Yeah, it's really hard for at this moment to predict. It's you know, as you know, we are you know, in communication with the FDA, you know, around the study and the study design. So we'll be able, you know, once that's done, to give an update on that you know, hopefully soon.
What else here?
There is one that says, is there age for the clinical trial? In similar epilepsy trials, I have seen minimum ages of 1, 2, 4.
Yeah, I'm not you know, I mean, able to give already specific details, you know, around the specific around the specific elements, because this is really, you know, also you know, we want to make sure that, you know, all, you know, that's you know, this you know, as especially as we are kind of in the current discussions, but certainly, you know, the age really, you know, in different phases of development. Is really driven by the data that's available. Of course, we know that the big burden is starting really early, you know, under the age of 2, as you mentioned here. So development programs in general often, you know, likely go beyond, you know, a phase 2 study. So often then, you know, age ranges then expand or change or get then adapted to the entire population at some point in clinical development.
Okay.
Thank you so much. I think that addresses some of the questions that were left here. Oh, here we go. Something coming from Eric Wingard. All right, just more of a discussion about loss of function versus gain of function, and the effects on neurons might be as complicated and is not necessarily going to be binary. There might be a gain or loss of function depending on which specific measure you're looking at. Is it persistent current? Is it a hyperpolarizing shift? Or what? Okay. So I think we'll stop there. We're a few minutes behind here, but if we have a short break, I'll let Casey take over here and tell us about the break in the next session, maybe. Or Hillary.
I'm going to take over. I think Casey's audio cut out. Thank you guys so much. And, you know, I wanted to hop on, Dietrich, before you started, to say it would not be a Keith syndrome event if we didn't run over. That's why we built in the breaks, because we always use them. So thank you so much to you and all of our presenters today. Since we have gone through our whole break, what we're going to do from here, hop back over to the sessions. We're going to go into the new session, which is the research roundtable, and we're going to get started just a few minutes late over there. And I just want to encourage people, you know, throughout, if you're taking breaks, to check out the expo, and we will see you in a few minutes in the next session. Thank you guys so much.